precipitates, because there is a precipitation there. And in the vitreous body, we have opacities. And usually these opacities are seen by the patient like the flies in the sight. So this acute iron splitting may lead also to one formation of the so-called hypopium. This is hypopium here, when we have a push into the anterior chamber with the level, hypopium. This is white. And this push usually is sterile push, because these are killed leukocytes. Also, we may have the so-called hyphema. Hyphema means blood into the anterior chamber. Blood into the anterior chamber, outer level. Very often this hyphema is after contusion of the eye globe, after trauma. But sometimes it may come after iron cyclitis. So the symptoms of the iron cyclitis are dull pain in the eye, impairment of the vision, lowering of the vision because of these precipitates, photophobia, excessive tearing, which means epiphora. And the typical signs are ciliary inaction. Remember, when we have iron cyclitis, usually we have a red eye. Red eye. Because the blood vessels here near the limbus are dilated. Also, we have meiosis. You can see constructed pupil. Constructed pupil. Tyndall effect, I told you about it in the effects, and hypopium. So, when we have iron cyclitis, the complications, these complications are very near to the beginning of the iron cyclitis. For several hours, it can give the so-called posterior synechias. These are posterior synechias, and this is adhesion between the iris and the lens capsule. And when we try to dilate the pupil, it is not round, it is like cadetylene. It's because of these synechias. Very often are the posterior synechias. More rare are the anterior synechias. It's written here. It's adhesion between the surface of the cornea and the iris. Also, secondary open-angle glaucoma is very often. But the most often are the posterior synechias. You can see the posterior synechias here also. And sometimes it's forming like a cyclic membrane here in front of the lens. This is posterior synechias and cyclic membrane. When we have iron cyclitis, it's very important to make a differential diagnosis with acute glaucoma. unless we have pain in the both diseases. First, these diseases may happen in one and the same age. You know, the acute glaucoma usually is the age after 35. Acute iridocyclitis usually may come in the same age. Sometimes, very rare, it's in 20, 25 years of age. In both we have red eye because of inaction. So, in acute iritis, we are talking about perilimbo inaction. And in acute glaucoma, we are talking about congestive inaction. But as in the both, we have pain. This pain in iridocyclitis is dull pain, and pain in palpation, when we palpate. So, in acute glaucoma, it's very intense pain with vomiting. So, in acute iridocyclitis, we have clear cornea and edema of the cornea in acute glaucoma. The anterior chamber is normal depth, but we have cells there precipitates in acute iridocyclitis and shallow anterior chamber in acute glaucoma. Very important is the pupil. As in acute iridocyclitis, it's narrow, it's constructed by this reactive meiosis, and in acute glaucoma is dilated. Remember, the pupil is dilated, it's not round, dilated. And the pressure is very important also. We have rock hard in acute glaucoma. Very high pressure, about 60, 70 millimeters. In acute iridocyclitis, it's normal pressure. Why this is so important? Because if we mistake the treatment, acute iridocyclitis, we begin with dilating of the pupil, with atropine. If you put in acute glaucoma one drop of atropine, by 60 it will become 100 the eye pressure, and will destroy the optic. So, it's very important what kind of disease is when we have a diagnosis. So, you can see these are also complications of iridocyclitis. And you can see here cataract after chronic iridocyclitis. Also, you have here posterior synechis, cataract, keratopathy, and so on and so on. This is Behçet disease. This is another syndrome. But before that, I want to try to see where is here the treatment. After that, I'll talk about the syndromes. How we treat the acute iridocyclitis? You see, we may have many causes of this. In 60% of the cases, we don't understand, we don't know what is really the cause. We may have many investments, we may have check of the whole body for infection. But we have to begin with the treatment, knowing or without knowing what is the cause. That's why we begin with mydriasis. We have to dilate the pupil. And the second, remember, it's steroid therapy. This steroid therapy, the therapeutic, the mydriasis we make with atropine, tropicamine, midrum, epinephrine, and so on. There are a lot of drops. Steroid therapy usually we use with drops, but sometimes in heavier cases we use injections. They are subconnectival peribulbar injections with steroid. Also, we give antibiotic therapy, antiviral therapy is the third. You can see the prognosis usually is good in the first and the second cases. But as the iridocyclitis comes again and again and again, it can come after 6 months again, after 1 year again. It can progress to a chronic stage. But the prognosis is good. If we begin with the mydriasis and steroid therapy, usually acute iridocyclitis we cure for about 1 month. And what about the chronic iridocyclitis? If in chronic iridocyclitis, there is a lot of complications. This posterior synechias and membrane, cyclic membrane, you can see here, also lead to angle closure glaucoma with iris bombata because the fluid cannot pass through the pupil from posterior to anterior chamber. And there is iris bombata or iris entomato. And the pressure becomes from 20 up to 40, 50, 60. And also we have a cataract. You can see here the precipitates, but also opacification of the lens. These are precipitates, which are back at the cornea, you can see. And the pacification of the lens, it leads to cataracts. When we have a cataract, of course, we have to make surgery and to remove this lens with another lens, which is an intraocular lens, an artificial lens. And what is the treatment when we have a pupillary block? When we have a pupillary block and very high pressure, we do the so-called YAC laser iridotomies. What does it mean? YAC laser is yttrium aluminium garnet laser, which we make a holes in the iris. And the fluid pass not through the pupil, pass from these holes we make in the iris. It's create a shunt to allow aqueous humor to pass from the posterior to the anterior chamber. If we have a cataract, we'll extract and make extraction artificial lens there. And here I'll talk about these little syndromes. There are a lot of syndromes, of course. You know, the syndromes are diseases which include several spots of diseases. As the eye is involved, but are involved also at the mouth and so on. In Behçet disease, what happens in the eye? The first, this one here in the retina, it's vasculitis in the retina. The second is hypopia. We have in Behçet hypopia, like here. This is HIF retinopathy. In HIF we have salt and pepper. Cotton wool spots in the retina. So, what about the choroid retinitis? You can see the incidence of choroid retinitis, it's not very often. There are 4 cases per 100,000. As in the retina, there are no nerve fibers for pain. We have no pain. We may have blurred vision, floaters. Sometimes the patient don't know there is a choroiditis. And when we examine for something else, we see the retina and see the choroiditis. If the problem is in the macula and the fovea, of course, the visual acuity is down and the patient comes immediately to us. But if it's in the periphery, they maybe don't know the patient's choroiditis. Well, so the treatment is antibiotic therapy, steroid therapy, and depending on etiological. So you can see here focal choroid retinitis, multifocal choroid retinitis. This is toxoplasmosis. Very important is this toxoplasmosis. It gives such pigmented spots. We are talking about congenital toxoplasmosis and acquired toxoplasmosis. And usually it involves the both eyes. And usually it involves the macula. Here we can see Behçet disease and hypopia. So in the very past, in the past times, many of the syphilitic patients were discovered by the eye doctors. Why? You can see in the retina this picture. As it's not very often today, it's very rare, of course. But in the past, many of the eye doctors discovered syphilis in the patients. This is toxoplasmosis here, I told you. Very often it involves the macula, like here in the macula, and when it's in the macula, the visual acuity of this eye is 0.1, because in the periphery the visual acuity 0.1. You can see also a tuberculum here. In tuberculosis we can see a tuberculum. This is very rare, of course. This is something, another kind of disease. It's called sympathetic ophthalmia. We'll talk about this when we talk about traumas. But sympathetic ophthalmia means specific bilateral inflammation of the uveal tract due to chronic irritation of one eye. Usually it's caused by perforating wound. But very rare it may be caused by surgery, as the surgery is also trauma to the eye. And we may see precipitates in the other eye, trauma of one eye, and precipitates and irritation and dull pain in the other eye. If we remove the traumatized eye in 2 weeks after trauma, the sympathetic ophthalmia disappears. But usually we don't do this. We begin with treatment with corticosteroids, a very high dosage, and after that low dosage of corticosteroids for many, many months. And usually we treat this. I'll talk about this disease when we'll talk about traumas. This is another situation. In some diseases in the eye, in some disorders, it comes rubeosis iris. Normally, there are many, many blood vessels in the iris, but usually we don't see these blood vessels. When we see blood vessels like here, they are new blood vessels. There is new vascularization of the iris. And usually it happens when we have two disorders in the retina. One is diabetic retinopathy, and the other is occlusion of the vein of the retina. Something like infarctus of the retina. So these new blood vessels are very dangerous. Why? Because there are many connective tissue with these blood vessels. And this connective tissue covers the arterial chamber angle and leads to secondary glaucoma. And we cannot do almost nothing can do. Why? Because we can remove by laser some of these blood vessels, but they come again. We can put anti-VGF into the anterior chamber and construct these blood vessels, but this is only for several months. After that, they come again. So very hard is to treat this, very hard. So the real treatment is to make a laser to the retina, not to allow to come these blood vessels on the eyes. So do you hear me, or I'm talking only for me?
We can hear you.
Yes.
Okay. So we'll talk about tumors. And the tumors are very important. And remember, in ophthalmology, there are two main malignant tumors. One is retinoblastoma, which is coming from the retina. And we'll talk about retinoblastoma when we talk about retina. And the retinoblastoma is congenital in children. But melanoma malignum or uveomelanoma comes in any age. And this is very malignant tumor. And we are talking about iris melanoma, ciliary body melanoma, and choroidal melanoma. So this is a very, very important tumor, and this is the main tumor from the uvea, which is malignant. You can see a melanoma of the eyes. Here is pigmented, here is apigmented, very rare, we have apigmented melanoma without a pigment. But when we have a melanoma of the iris, it's about 5% of all cases. And usually this patient comes to us usually in time. Because the patient see this in the miracle or somebody does it wrong with the eye. And usually this patient comes in time to the eye doctors. And we can do something to make a resection and to save the eye blood. But when it's a pigmented melanoma of the in the uvea, in the choroid, you can see it involves the retina. And when it is exactly in the fovea here, in the center of the retina, the visual acuity is lower, and this patient comes also in time to us. But sometimes it's in the periphery of the eye. If it's in the periphery of the eye, remember there is no pain, as there are no nerve fibers for pain in the retina and the choroid. Very often the patient comes very late to us with a very big tumors there. It's very important how big is the tumor. Very important. If it's more than 8 to 10 millimeters, we cannot preserve the eye. But sometimes they are 16, 17 millimeters, these tumors. You can see this tumor, this tumor, this one. And as I said earlier, there is no pain. If you have, if you made perimetry, of course, we'll discover a scotoma somewhere. Very often, we are not sure it's a tumor or hemorrhage in the uterus. Of course, we make a lot of investments. We accept the slit lamp examination. Of course, we do ultrasonography, echography. It's very important. The second is computed tomography or MRI. MRI.
Professor.
Yes.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, you can.
In what age this tumor of the iris, what's the usual age of onset for this tumor?
The usual age? So
yes.
the usual age, it's after 40, but sometimes we may have, it can come in any age. I had in the past such patients who are 20 years old. But usually the age is after 40, about 50, 60 years of age. But we have not only me, we have such tumors in the age of 20, okay? But remember, in any kind of age we may have. It's a rare tumor. It's not very often, of course. But it is very dangerous tumor. You know, it comes from nevus. In the eye, we may have nevi, like on the skin. But when we have a melanosis in the eye, we just observe it. It's not a tumor. When it becomes to progress, to become larger, it's a tumor. And you can see, we can make a computer tomography like here, and you can observe here, you can see the tumor. We can make a magnetic resonance imaging, and you can see the tumor here. You can see this is ultrasonography, we can also see the tumor. And it's very important to measure this tumor, how large is it. Why? I told you, if it's less than 10 millimeters, usually we can preserve the eye globe. But if you have a tumor more than 12 millimeters or more than 16, we have to remove the eye globe to preserve the life of this patient. Why? Remember, 50% of these tumors lead to metastasis. And these metastasis are to the lung, also here. And that's why we have to remove the eye globe. This is called enucleation, to preserve the life of this patient. If it's stays there, this tumor, it becomes exteriorization, going out of the eye globe. And that's, if it's go out of the eye globe, we have to do another kind of surgery. It's called exanteration, removing of the whole content of the orbit. So it is very rare. In Bulgaria, we have about 10 to 12 cases per year. And in nowadays, there are a lot of treatment of this. So I told you, if we have a tumor in the iris, we can resect it. And this eye will be okay. If it's in the choroid, we can do some therapy with teeth plaques. You can see this is Ruten plaques. This is Ruten plaques, which we apply there when exactly on the place of the tumor. And this stays there 7 days. After 7 days, we remove this. Usually, the ruthenium destroys the tumor. Of course, this retina, like here, is also destroyed. It will be not functioning, this retina, not visual acuity here, but we preserve the eye. Also, there is the so-called proton therapy. The proton therapy is the most modern therapy here. Usually is the most expensive also this. Also, we may use the so-called gamma knife. The most of this we don't do here in Bulgaria. But there are some centers in the world and in Europe. Because our patients are not so many, I told you. We send our patients there to treat with proton therapy and gamma knife. But very, very important, I told you, is the how large is. And remember, 50% are giving metastasis. Also, there are some benign tumors, and I told you about the nevus. The nevi, choroidal nevi, are in 11% of population, you can see. And when we have such a nevus, I have such patients which I look every 3 to 6 months. And 7% of the population has some nevus. You can see the nevus usually in the retina, but we observe this nevus and are looking if there any bigger or not. So to see the tumors here, remember about melanoma malignum. I'll tell you a little in advance about retinoblastoma. It's another tumor. I told you there are two main malignant tumors in the ophthalmology. And retinoblastoma comes in children. It comes from the retina. And usually it's congenital. And as it's congenital, it comes in babies. As the baby cannot say to us what is the problem with the eyes, usually the mother and the father see something wrong with the baby. And the first one to come is the so-called leukocuria. Leukocuria means what? Means white pupil. White pupil. Leukocuria. In some cases, the parents can see white pupil. And when they come to us, we can observe, of course, by ophthalmoscopy, by computer tomography, by ultrasonography, the tumor. But remember, this retinoblastoma, in 30%, it's bilateral. The both eyes are involved, not only the one eye. It's very rare, of course, but there is also trilateral retinoblastoma in both eyes and in the brain. It is very malignant. And as it's congenital, after we treat some baby, and very often we remove one eye, after this patient becomes bigger, it becomes 30 years old, he wants or she to have a child. Of course, we advise him or her not to have a baby. Why? 50% of population of this man or woman will be with retinoblastoma. 50%. That's why it's not very good to have a child. The patients, don't hear very often to us. So, all the tumors in the eye have four stages. The first stage is intraretinal, the second is intraocular, the third is intraorbital, the tumor becomes out of the eye, and the fourth is keep generalization or metastasis. So remember here from the whole of Uvea, remember please the speed is, because this is very often. This is very often. Parasitic are very often. And you have to make a differential diagnosis between iridocyclitis and conjunctivitis. Remember, conjunctivitis, we have a red eye, but don't have pain. In iridocyclitis, we have pain. you have to make a differential diagnosis between arthrocyclitis and acute glaucoma. Remember the pupil. In arthrocyclitis, we have constructed pupil. In acute glaucoma, we have dilated pupil. And if we don't treat, of course, arthrocyclitis, it becomes a chronic arthrocyclitis and very dangerous to the eye. Remember, as in some ankylosing spondylitis, there are such patients who know this problem. They have 1, 2, 3, 5 times arthrocyclitis. I have a patients who come and bringing dexamethasone to me, knowing something is wrong, to make injections there. And this problem comes usually in any age, but in some age, in women, after 50, in climax, it's very often. Very often. Because of the very many causes there. So, this is meiosis, reactive meiosis. You can see red eye. And there is a very interesting what kind of diseases can give a red eye. There are a lot of them, of course. Conjunctivitis, arthrocyclitis, keratitis, glaucoma. And we have to make differentiation between what kind of infection or something else is giving this red eye. But we can treat this. We can treat. Remember about hyphema on the down picture, blood. Hypopion, it's very important. Hypopion. I told you, hypopion coming from outside. This is a sterile hypopion. Sterile. And that's why there are cute leukocytes there. The treatment, of course, is the same as corticosteroids and antibiotic therapy. Hepatitis. So, as we don't talk enough about parotiditis, the intermediate to uveitis, there are no pain, no real pain in parotiditis. There are some hepatitis like this. They see like something like flies in front of the eyes. But I really don't say anything about melanoblastoma of the of the ciliary body. So melanoblastoma of the ciliary body is very dangerous because we don't see immediately this, and second, it gives a lot of metastasis. The first metastasis are from the tumors of the ciliary body. So remember these precipitates. These are very, very important. Remember the Tyndall effect also. I cannot show really, this is like a Tyndall effect here. You can see something like a Tyndall effect here. Remember a lot of causes of this. It can come from any part of the body. Usually when we have a patient with arthrocyclitis, we examine all parts of the body. we go to the dental to see the teeth. We go to the to see the lung. We go to every ENT specialist and so on and so on. But remember, only in 40% of the cases we know the real cause. In 60%, we don't know what is the real cause. But of course, we begin with the treatment immediately without knowing really the cause of the this. If you have questions, I'm ready to answer.
So, Professor, to differentiate between nevi and the malignant melanoma, the only difference is in the thickness.
Between melanoma and what? The nevus?
Nevus, yes.
So, not the thickness only, the how large is it? If there are any blood vessels there. Usually in melanoma there are blood vessels. In the nevus there are no blood vessels. And that's why we make another check. We have another check we do, of course, this kind of examination, maybe I have here somewhere, examination, this one. We have a check, we install there and make pictures of the retina, such pictures of the retina. So, very important is to check the nevus, but immediately we have to begin to treat if it's melanoma. And as magnetic resonance imaging, we put a contrast there and we see are there any blood vessels or not. If there are any blood vessels in this nevus, it's not a nevus, it's melanoma maligna. Okay? Other questions? It's very important to observe this nevus. I have a patient, a woman with a nevus about 6 papilla diameters. We measure how large is the papilla, and if it's 4 papilla diameters, like 4 or 6 or 10 or how long, how large is. Of course, here is very important the diagnostic. But in any kind of melanoma malignant, we have to check the whole body. Are there any metastasis or not? So remember about inflammations, remember about the tumors. Of course, the inflammations are very, and the tumors are, of course, very, very rare. So in your practice, maybe you'll see such inflammations. Maybe you don't see any tumor, of course, but you have to know this. Remember about these precipitates. They are like a triangle with a base down on 6 o'clock. And there is a dull pain, remember. This hereditary congenital anomalies, was very rare, but we have to know about them. So, are there any questions? Another questions? No another questions, so I wish you a good day. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.